So we're very lucky to have Professor Catriona Morrison here to speak to us today. Catriona is head of department at Heriot Watt, she started off at the University of Glasgow, did a PhD in York, and then took a postdoctoral position at York, first lectureship at Cardiff, and then came up to Robert Gordon, and then back down to Leeds, which is where I met Catriona. And Catriona, I had the honour of having Catriona examine my PhD as the internal examiner. So that was a real privilege for me, and it's a real privilege for me to introduce her. Super, that's why I recommend it.
Oh, Akira, thank you so much. What a warm introduction, that's lovely. And you are a great student of IVA, as you well know. So what I want to talk about today, and thank you very much, first of all, for having me and for such a great turnout on a Friday afternoon. I'm very impressed. I'd like to talk about recent advances in autobiographical memory. As Akira says, I'm head of department now at Heriot Watt. So when I actually started to put the talk together after giving the title, I thought, it's actually, you know, a wee while since I've collected data, but the papers that I'm going to talk about are papers that have come out in the past year or two, and also I'm going to provide some background to those papers and sort of give you an idea of where the research has come from. So I thought I'd begin by getting us in the mood for memory with just playing a little bit of the Beatles. And I'm going to talk about some of the research that we've done that was quite good fun and involved Beatles music. It's just getting you nice and relaxed so that you know you're gonna sort of lose that kind of critical sort of attitude. And oh, that was lovely and relaxing. Right. Okay, now I'm sure you'd rather listen to the rest of that than to listen to me, but nonetheless, must crack on. So I'm thinking of memory, and what I'm going to talk about is some of the ways in which we have looked at investigating autobiographical memory, using sort of slightly alternative tools and means to the traditional ones, with a view to accessing memories that might otherwise not be easily accessible to consciousness. Now, Akira may remember this event. This is a younger Akira and a younger Catriona, and yes, I am pregnant at the time this photo was taken. And I don't know if you remember this event, Akira, but there's something very significant about this event that my daughter, who is now 14, she was 3 at the time, she remembers this to this day. So we all went and had a lovely Japanese lunch, and it was all going swimmingly well until she was playing with the chopsticks, the wooden chopsticks, and she slipped. And the chopsticks went, like that. And the whole lunch was really ruined for all of us. But I was kind of going, will you stop it? Stop it. We were having a nice lunch there. So, you know, sort of like, that's probably something that Akira might not spontaneously remember. But if I say, you know, an issue with chopsticks, then that one might come to mind. But okay, so I think what I want to talk about, as I say, is autobiographical memory. So memories for our lives. And I think that the reason that this is interesting is because it's all about our sense of self and who we are. So I think, and I'll talk a little bit about some of the stuff that I did before I came to this line of research, but I really like this because it gives us a real sense of who we are as individuals. And there's very interesting things that we can do with autobiographical memory to investigate a sense of self as well. Now, you've probably done this many times before, so I'll run through it quickly. So, recalling your earliest memory, how old were you when that event occurred? What was the weather like when that event occurred? What were you wearing? And was it emotional? Now, these might seem like slightly odd questions, but the reason that we ask them is that these are the sorts of questions that the police ask, for example, in interview situations, the sorts of questions that are asked in the courtroom, and it's the kind of information that people are expected to be able to provide to be perceived as reliable witnesses on both sides. So people think they have to provide that information, and people making judgments about their memory also think that they should be able to remember those kinds of details. And so what I want to do is talk about some of the work that we've done quite recently that suggests that some of these questions are maybe not the best questions to be asking. And so thinking of the question of how old were you, if I did it with a general audience and I do a show of hands and I say, you know, hold your hand up if you remember anything from below the age of five, then most of the hands go up. Keep your hand up if it's from below the age of four, many hands still up. Below the age of three, and you see quite a remarkable phenomenon that happens in every audience that you do it with, that a load of hands go down between four and three. So this is the concept of infantile amnesia. And you do get people with earlier memories than three, but generally speaking, we can't remember our very, very early years. So infantile amnesia, autobiographical memory, it emerges around the age of 3.5. Infantile amnesia is this feature of it that we can't remember things from very early in life. Nobody, we think, can remember things from below the age of one. Or can they? So a colleague and I have a very, very large sample of people's earliest memories from about 12,000 people. And there are about 700 of those memories that people claim are from below the age of about one and a half. And the interesting thing for me is moving from a background in experimental psychology where everything was kind of, you know, fairly, it was all about numbers and ANOVAs and controlling things. In this line of research, you can't do that, and you have to make a judgment about whether memories are true or not. So are we going to throw out the 700 or so memories that people claim to be from below the age of about one and a half? And if I have time, I can talk about some of my thinking on that. So, two views I want to present on memory. A childhood is what anyone wants to remember of it. It leaves behind no fossils, except perhaps in fiction. That's Carol Shields in The Stone Diaries. In contrast, another author says, some people have tried to persuade me that my early memories are not authentic, but I believe strongly in the power and persistence of memory. In our brains, past and present coexist. They occupy, as it were, adjoining rooms, but there are some rooms we never enter. We seem to have lost the keys, but they can be retrieved. Hilary Mantel from Father Figured. The work that I've done, and I hope I can persuade you a little bit about that today, is that I favour the latter point of view. I think there's a lot more in there than is easily accessible. And it's about using cues like an event with chopsticks and some nice nostalgic music. Just some of the things that we can do to try and get those memories out again. Okay, so to explain how I came to this line of research, I started out working in language on something called age of acquisition. So age of acquisition is the age at which we acquire words, the age at which words enter our vocabulary. We usually do this by asking adults to rate huge lists of words. So it's quite difficult to get measures from children, although we have got a big database of children's vocabulary, compared this with adult ratings, and there's a close correspondence. So what you're doing here is you're giving people lists of words and you're asking them to rate the age at which they learned them. Now, this might seem like a tricky thing to do, but when we correlate those ratings with the measures of children's vocabulary, there's a very close correspondence. So adults are able to make ratings of the age at which they learn words and do it, you know, with some accuracy. So this measure of word learning age is highly predictive in language tasks in a whole range of domains. So it works for the young adults that we started out testing. It works in bilinguals. It works across languages. It works in aphasia. And the way it works is that the early words are more robust. They're better preserved in aphasia, for example. They're better preserved in Alzheimer's disease. So it's the early stuff that remains when there's damage. And in healthy young adults, things like reaction times are faster if you ask people to name words and pictures, do lexical decision or whatever. So age of acquisition, a very powerful predictor for language. And so this is where I came to the memory work. So we thought, well, if this is such a powerful predictor in language, can we use this to transfer it across to memory and think about early memories? And the time at which I started doing this was arriving in Leeds, and we had that great Leeds memory group that was just emerging at that time. So it was a great group of people all trying to think about how they could work together and bring together their respective knowledge. So this was my tiny contribution. So we think of age of acquisition is early language. How do we apply that or transfer it into memory? Well, let's think about early memories in terms of ageist encoding. So the age at which an event occurred. So this is a study that I did with Martin Conway, where we thought, well, is it the case that early words lead to earlier memories? And in fact, we found that it was the case that the words had to be in your vocabulary around 12 months before you started having memories for those objects. So what we did here was, on my next slide, yeah, this explains the sort of method that we used. So if we take 50 imageable nouns like church and cabbage and train, and we have 50 people rating them. So we just adopt the rating scale that we would use for age of acquisition. And we said to people, give us a brief description of your earliest memory of cabbage and the age at which the event occurred, the age at encoding. Now, this might seem like an even stranger thing to do, and it might seem like a very tricky thing to do. And I think we probably said to our participants, you cannot leave the room until you have given us these ratings. Come on, think, dredge the memory banks. And actually, people were able to do it. So they gave us, and I did try this before I did it with on this kind of scale, 7-point scale. I had a questionnaire where I just said, give me a memory for none. And how old were you? And I had one guy going, I was 19, and it was when I saw nuns on the run. And I thought, no, this isn't quite, that can't be your first memory of nun. So we found that this scale actually, encouraged people to think about early memories and to give us earlier memories. So we get these age at encoding measures then, age at encoding ratings, and we look at what predicts them. And importantly, the best predictor of your age of earliest memories is the age at which you acquired the corresponding vocabulary. So you've got to have cabbage established in your vocabulary before you're able to set down a memory for it. Other things vary in how confident are you in the memory. That was important in predicting the age at encoding, so you're more confident in early memories. But these other measures that we typically use in age of acquisition and language experiments don't seem to be that important for age at encoding. And if we look at the mean scores here, so we've got the memory age at encoding in months. So this is 5 and a bit years. Language age of acquisition months, so a bit younger. And then the confidence, just so you know, is kind of middling. It's not bad. So as I say, it does sound like quite a strange task to do. But in fact, people are moderately confident that the memories they're giving, the ratings they're giving are accurate. And importantly for us, what we see here, the difference between the age of the memory and the age at which you learn the vocabulary, there's about 12 months of a lag there. So our explanation of this is that there has to be something going on whereby you acquire the word, it's in your vocabulary, and you have to sort of give it some kind of contextualization, have some practice with it, before the point at which you're able to set down the earliest memory for it. Okay, so that's evidence that suggests that language is important in this whole issue of infantile amnesia and setting down early autobiographical memories. To corroborate this is a great experiment that I wish I'd done, but I didn't. I don't know, some of you may well know of the magic shrinking machine. This is work by Harlene Hain and her colleagues in New Zealand. So what you do here is you've got this machine that is sufficiently sort of engaging for young children that they really want to learn how to use it. And what happens is the child puts a big ball in the top, learns how to use the machine. He has to crank the handle and he has to do it himself. And lo and behold, out the bottom comes a small ball. Now, children of that age have conservation of mass, so they know that big ball in and small ball out is unusual. And basically, the experiment is designed to attract their attention and make this event memorable. So what did they find? Well, first of all, children, when they were tested at a later point, 12 or 18 months later, children only remembered the things that they had actively talked about. So a careful record was taken of what the children had talked about on the original encounter with the magic shrinking machine. And interestingly, children only recalled the story of the magic shrinking machine in the narrative that they had available to them at the original encounter with the event at the time of encoding. So children never described the story of encountering the magic shrinking machine in any other language than that was available to them when the event occurred, first of all. And the conclusion from this is that language, again, is key to setting down autobiographical memories. So language is only one of many kind of levels of explanation for the emergence of autobiographical memory. There are other people who argue more in terms of like neurological development. You know, these are different levels and non-competing levels of explanation, I think. And certainly there's some very persuasive data in relation to language. So language is a determinant of development of autobiographical memory, we believe, but how can we access the full range of people's autobiographical memories? What could we do in terms of just fully tapping it? So if you think about, for example, the scent of your mother's perfume, smell, an interesting way of tapping memory. And I couldn't put it more eloquently than Proust, who said... So Proust, for those of you who don't know, Proust was in Paris and he was walking past boulangerie, patisserie, and he smelled the smell of the fresh Madeleine cakes being baked, coming out of the oven. And instantly, on the street in Paris, with that the presence of that smell, he was transported back to his grandmother's parlour. He felt it was almost like, you know, a sort of like going through a time tunnel, and he felt this very strong sensation of being back in his grandmother's parlour. And the way he put it was, when nothing else subsists from the past, after the people are dead, after the things are broken and scattered, the smell and taste of things remain poised a long time, like souls, bearing resiliently on tiny and almost impalpable drops of their essence, the immense edifice of memory. So, you know, as I say, I wouldn't want to try to paraphrase that, but the sense of this very powerful sensation of being transported by a smell. Well, we looked at smell and memory. This is going back a few years now, because this is from Olivia Handley's work, who was a PhD student of mine in my Cardiff days. And at that time, what we were looking at, her PhD was looking at people who we labelled as sort of pre-symptomatic for developing Alzheimer's disease, in that they had a first degree relative with Alzheimer's disease. And we were working with some geneticists in the hospital at Cardiff and trying to look at this particular gene, APOE, and also at familial risks. So, you know, as I say, this having this first degree relative who's got Alzheimer's, and seeing could we put these two together and look at features in still healthy older adults that might be indicative, suggestive of them going on to develop Alzheimer's disease, you know, sort of like trying to not prevent, but trying to anticipate cognitive decline. And we had a huge battery of neuropsychological measures, everything you can possibly think of. And fairly late in the day, as we were preparing this, literature started to emerge on links between olfaction and cognitive decline. So we thought we'd include this, and it was by far the most sort of telling, revealing measure that we had in our, getting ahead of myself, that we had in our whole battery of tests. So we had older adult siblings who were regarded as at risk and not at risk, so who had a sibling with Alzheimer's disease or not. And we looked at the genotype as well. So we looked at a particular presentation of this APOE gene and how that worked in relation to various tests. But the important thing is that those with the APOE genotype that we were concerned about, that the literature was starting to emerge on, and those with a family risk, performed poorly on olfactory memory tasks, and there was an interaction between them, so that if you had the genotype and if you had a sibling, tests on olfactory memory were particularly depressed. Now, these were healthy older adults who, you know, as far as tests like the mini mental are concerned, were in the normal range, but it was concerning that their olfactory memory was so depressed in comparison with the other groups. Unfortunately, we never got the money to follow this up, because it would have been great to follow up this group of still healthy older adults and see what happened to them. But the money wasn't there, so that's where we left the story, unfortunately. And then there's music. So I wanted to play you this as well, because I think this is great for those of you who know Elbow. I think this is it's a really nice kind of expression of how memory can transport you back. Okay, so I just think that's quite a nice description of it. So, you know, he's obviously very busy, preoccupied, and lots of stuff going on. And then just this song sort of seeps into his consciousness, and he's not that busy person anymore. He's in this place he was 5 years ago and 3,000 miles away. Well, we took a look at memory and music a few years back when it was the British Association Festival of Science, and it was in Liverpool. And we thought, well, why not take this opportunity? It's going to be in Liverpool. We could present some stuff there. Got a little bit of money from the ESRC, put together a website, and we got about 5,000 memories. Beatles memories, we got them from all across the globe. Young people, old people, men and women, and, you know, just a really, really, I mean, it was one of these things that it was, we were very fortunate that it had the backing of the British Association, and it also, it was one of these things that was, you know, journalists loved it, so it was quite easy to advertise it quite widely, and people really enjoyed doing it as well. So what we did you do it, by the way, Akira? Yeah, excellent, good man. what we did was, we said, right, we want you to give us your most memorable, most significant memory of the Beatles. It could either be buying an album, it could be going to a concert, could be a personal encounter, it could be, and we got quite a few personal encounters, and this is where, you know, you got to sort of like use your judgment about whether these memories are real or not. There were some that were definitely not real, but I won't talk about these anymore. But you know, in that 5,000, you know, you're talking less than 100 that we thought, I don't really believe it. And I'm going to show you on in a minute that I think it's quite believable and it's quite charming. So I'm really sorry that this graph is not very elegant, but I hope it's, you know, the sort of visual display is fairly clear. For those of you who know memory and the reminiscence bump, this will look very familiar. So what we have on the x-axis is we have age buckets, 5 years, so 0 to 5 years, 6 to 10, all the way up to 76 to 80 rather. The count is at the y-axis, so the number of memories in each of these age buckets. And what you see is a very typical reminiscence bump, as I say. So this is what we get with all autobiographical memories, although we do usually get a bit of a recency effect at the end if you're concentrating on older adults. But of course, we had all age groups submitting their memories here. So what you find is that the peak for the memories is in the 11 to 15 year old age group. And this is slightly younger than what you find generally with autobiographical memories. So the peak for the reminiscence bump, the bulk of memories for your life, if you reflect on your life after about the age of 35, 40, then the bulk of memories from your life is in the 15 to 25 age buckets. We think, well, my theory is why it's slightly earlier here is that the 11 to 15 age group is the point at which you are forming your musical sense of self. So music is very, very, I mean, music is important as you get older, but it's really at this point, I think, that you're starting to properly make your choices about the kind of music that suits you. My daughter is 14 at the moment, and you know, it's just the music, I don't recognize it at all, but the music is so important to her, and it's so important to have the right t-shirt and be listening to the right stuff, and it's so important that mum doesn't know the band either. Okay, so, and as far as rehearsal and memory are concerned, what we find with the Beatles memories, and indeed other memories, if you do like flashbulb memories for significant events or whatever, you find that people can have very eloquent and vivid memories which they haven't recalled much in decades. So we think that music is a really good cue for memory, an underused cue, and that the memories even from decades ago appear to be generally very believable. Memory and emotion, very complex, doesn't work in a straightforward way. Of course, the memories for the Beatles are generally speaking very positive. Key negative, obviously, the death of John Lennon. Emotion is essential in making events more memorable, but emotion can also make events, make accounts of events less accurate. Just say Paul McCartney uses the Beatles songs as memory cues too. And here's one that I wanted to tell you, partly because, so this was, partly I'm interested because it was somebody from Leeds and we did the work in Leeds. So she says, saving up for my first holiday abroad, I found a second job as an usherette at the Leeds Odeon. Together with the films, there were live concerts, including the Beatles in 1963. The manager, Mr. Clark, told us that once the ticket holders were seated, we could stand in the side aisles next to the stage. Clearly, we were delighted. At the interval, the manager came to me and said that George Harrison wanted me to go backstage after the show. Well, in my innocence, I had no idea about the possible outcomes of such an encounter. All I could think was that my boyfriend was in the audience, as well as which I could not risk the wrath of my mother if I wasn't on the last bus home. The strange thing is that I didn't get excited about it, tell friends, etc. It is only now when I reflect back, I wonder if I would have taken the chance had it been John. I think she'd been quite fussy there. I think if any of the Beatles had asked me backstage, I wouldn't be worrying too much about. Maybe that's just me though. But you know, I mean, so with this, you know, this could be fantasy, but I don't get the sense that this is fantasy. I think the sense is quite a believable memory. You get your very small group of fantasists who might want to make this up. But, you know, there are little details in there as well that, you know, Mr. Clark, and actually I've omitted things like, you know, she's told us the time of the last bus home. It was 22:50. She remembers that. I believe that. I'd like to believe it anyway. So, just as an aside, this is not about, about memory, but just to kind of finish off the music stuff. So Steven Pinker's argued that music is auditory cheesecake. So he says, we like it, it's pleasurable, but we'd be none the worse without it. And when I've talked about the musical memories at things like Café Scientifiques and things like that, the audience get very, very upset, actually. And they're like, that's not true. You know, many of them come to these talks because they're interested in music anyway. But I argue as well that music isn't auditory cheesecake. Sorry, Steven Pinker, that's one thing you've got wrong. Because of the link to emotion, it affords us an important tool by which to encode and retrieve memories. And it's been a useful tool for us. So I just wanted to, quite quickly now, because we're running out of time, talk about debunking some memory myths. So what do we think about memory, and how does that compare with the reality, and what can we really remember about childhood? Very, very difficult to unpack this sort of stuff. We published a paper on this last year. It was a paper that the psychologist asked us to write for them, and it created a bit of a hoo-ha. And I think the editor of the Psychologist regretted asking us to write the paper in the end because he had a lot of grief. So there was letters going to and fro for a couple of months afterwards. We were being a bit controversial, but I don't think massively. I think maybe some of our terminology didn't help. So a number of studies, including one of our own, has examined beliefs about memory. You know, some people sort of have a belief that judges might have a different view or understanding of memory. And in fact, of course, they don't. They have exactly the same view and understanding as the rest of us. So let's have a look at three widely held beliefs which we don't think are true. So as I say, I'll run through these fairly quickly because it's getting on. So the first one, more detailed memories are more likely to be true. Well, 58 of the people that we surveyed agreed with the statement when that's applied to memories from childhood. So the more detailed a memory you have, the more likely that childhood memory is likely, the more likely it is to be true. 13% neither agreed or disagreed, so, you know, they could be open to persuasion, and we know that memory is highly open to persuasion anyway, and understanding of memory is highly open to persuasion. I think, as I say, we created a hoo-ha, and the reason is because we called it the mad belief, and, you know, associated some studies with it that that you might have then sort of like drawn the conclusion that these studies were a bit mad. But that wasn't what we meant, but maybe it just was unfortunate, the acronym in that case. More vivid memories are likely to be true. 68% of respondents agreed for memories of everyday events, 54% for memories of childhood events, 21% neither agreed nor disagreed. So there's a strong and pervasive belief that the more detailed and more vivid a memory is, the more likely that memory is to be accurate. In fact, and I won't go into the detail just now, but the scientific evidence is that more detailed, more vivid they are, the greater the likelihood is of error. And it goes back to this issue of people's expectations of what they should remember about events and what other people should remember about events. So if I'm to be a believable witness, I must be able to see what the weather was like on that day when I was 7 years old and we went to the park. Also, if we take the notion of trivial persuasion, this is the belief of more specific peripheral details included in a memory, the more likely it is to be correct. And that's not also that is not also the case. So peripheral details do not make for a correct, true account. And this often takes the form of verbatim accounts of conversations. So what exactly people said. Now, we don't remember verbatim accounts of conversations. We remember gist accounts, just like forms of conversations. So this kind of, she definitely said that we were going at 3 o'clock on Friday or whatever it might be. So people can't remember verbatim spoken utterances. They remember gists. Second, the burnt-in memory belief. So highly emotional experiences give rise to highly accurate memories. Well, they give rise to more memories. They're more highly emotional experiences are more memorable, but there's a question mark over whether they are also more accurate, because when something's emotional, there are all kinds of factors at play. So the classic one of, you know, if someone's in a crime situation and there's a weapon involved, then they're much less likely to remember the clothes that the attacker was wearing, you know, his appearance and other stuff that was going on, because their attentional focus is on that weapon. So it's a controversial belief, but it's widespread. So in this Magnuson et al. Study, over 70% of respondents believed memory for a dramatic event was better than memory for an everyday event. So, and it's quite, you know, what about this better? Dramatic events are more, overall more memorable, but it's whether these accounts of dramatic events are any more accurate. So, even higher, we found in our question where we asked people, do you believe your memories of emotional events, weddings, funerals, tragic events such as 9/11 are more or less accurate than memories for everyday events? So over 80% of our respondents believed that their own and memories for others' emotional events would be more accurate than memories of less emotional, more everyday events. Again, scientific evidence doesn't support this belief. There's a recent study to take a look at by Morgan and Southwick. As I've said, the relation between memory and emotion is highly complex, and it varies from situation to situation. As I've said already as well, very intense emotional experiences can lead to distorted memories and even to amnesia. When there are all these factors going on, then in fact, although the account is emotional and is as such memorable, then it's still not necessarily true. And the age at first memory belief, so I've talked about this already, about the age at encoding. So we took a look at this, we asked people about when they thought their own memory, their own earliest memories were, and when they thought other people's earliest memories are. I'll pass over that and just go to this table. So here we have people rating the ages and coding. How old were you when your earliest memory occurred? For your own memory, you could see from birth to the age of 5+, and others' memory. And what you see is that there's this interesting pattern where nobody believes that they have a memory from birth, but they believe that some other people do. And from one in our sample, but they believe that other people do. So this is shifted up. They believe that other people's memories are earlier than their own memories, curiously enough. So our own memories, as we've seen already, date to the age of about 3 or 4. Age of earliest memories from others dates from the age of about 2 to 3 years. And it could be because there are people who claim to have unusually early memories, and this distorts one's perception. Although there is now also some really interesting work by Patricia Bauer's lab that's come out recently on children that suggests that adults might be overestimating this 3.5 years average. So it's all up for grabs. So we know that people can't remember memories from the pre-verbal period. Memories from below the age of 5 are fragments. They're not full memories. And we think the full proper accounts of events date from about the age of 5 to 6 years. Okay, so this was looking for positive and negative memories. The only memories that you are certain are memories, not things that you got from photographs or from somebody telling you stories about them or whatever. And it was quite difficult to get the instructions right for this and just to say to people, because the hardest thing is that participants expect that they should be remembering things. And we had to explain that it's really okay if you don't remember very much. So you give a free description of each memory, modelled on police interviews, and ask them various things about clothes, what they were wearing, and only respond if you can actually remember. So scoring isn't straightforward. We had to, for example, cut out things that were too generic. So obviously people avoiding saying, well, it must have been a Saturday because. So people making inferences like that, people saying, well, my mother would have been with me because. It was a school day, so clothes, what were you wearing? I would have been wearing my school uniform. So we had to be careful with that. And Martin Conway, who I worked with on this, is particularly skeptical of people remembering details like clothes. So various questions: who was present, location, activity, how old were you, what were you wearing, what was the weather like, what did you think, what was the time, and how long did the event last? And here what we've got is the answers to those questions in terms of the details recalled. So activity, people are remembering a lot about that. Location, a lot as well. And who was there? And then it drops a bit for what were you thinking? What was the weather like? Even what was your age at the time? And then further down, how long did the event last? What time of day was the event? And what you were wearing? Well, this backs up Martin's view that people remember very little about that. So why is this interesting? It's interesting because it is the sort of question that questions that are being asked in police interviews that people are expected to answer and know about if they're to be regarded as believable witnesses. So essentially, adults remember what, where, who, plus a couple of other details. And of course, some of the details will probably be wrong, despite us our best efforts to make sure that they only gave us what they absolutely remembered. So lots of schematic stuff like, my mother was there, I was wearing my school uniform, and so on. So to summarize, Our research strongly suggests that language and memory are crucially linked, specifically this sort of emergence of autobiographical memory in early childhood. We think that music and other atypical cues can be very helpful in retrieving long forgotten events. And we're looking at different methods of trying to retrieve long forgotten events now. Our beliefs about memory, our own and other people's, seem in many ways to be quite a long way from the facts. And these are the people I need to thank. Thank you very much for listening.
Okay, so we have some time for questions, if anyone has any.
I was just wondering, when you do the surveys and you're asking about memories, if you separate out memories that are photographed, that they might have access to, because that can really create like a false memory. Mm-hmm. I wonder if that's even a question that is...
The photographs are a problem because they're you have to separate them. It got me thinking about there's a study, I can't remember who did it now, I just heard about it at a talk a couple of weeks ago, where they got photographs of people from their childhood, from their parents, and then they got the faces of these kids and they superimposed them on a picture of a hot air balloon, and then so they had lots of like real photos, and then they got these people in and they said, you know, do you remember this, and I think about 70% of people remembered being in a hot air balloon when they hadn't been in one. So photographs can really distort the sort of memory landscape. It's not to say they can't jog memories, and so one of the things that we've done is using the sense cams to where you wear it around your neck, and it sort of takes like just ticker tape type photos of your day, and they've used them with Alzheimer's patients with some success that it does trigger memory. So photographs can be useful, but they can also have a distorting influence as well.
It sort of speaks to that, I mean, I'm just wondering like how you deal with the fact that a lot of the memories that people tell you are going to be incorrect.
Yes.
And, you know, whether you've ever done studies where you try and corroborate the people who might have been there at the same time. And, I mean, do you care if they're correct, or...?
It's a good question. To an extent, no. Because it comes back to this sense of self. So we know they're not videotape accounts of our lives. We know that, generally speaking, there's some tendency to have a slightly rosy image of your past, but that's self-preservation. So there's an extent to which, you know, that's fine, and it's like, you know, the Chinese whisper thing, and, you know, things change in the retelling and everything. It does become problematic for us in this sort of situation where you really want accuracy from people. So that's kind of what that last study was about trying to say, you know, suspend your ideas that, you know, we're expecting this from you, just tell us what, you know, what you really truly remember.
Do you think maybe to come back to not to think about people wearing, you know, remembering what clothes were. So if you actually come up with things that are quite unusual rather than, you know, what was happening and where, do you get the idea that that's more likely to be true because it's unusual? Martin obviously doesn't believe.
probably, to be awkward. I don't know. I mean, what would be unusual? Like, and I remember that I had curry for lunch that day or something. That is the sort of thing that, you know, again, people perceive as being, oh, that well, you know, the other stuff must be true, because remembering an unusual fact like that, and it's a trivial fact, then she, you know, but I think the evidence actually goes the other way and suggests that, you know, these very, I mean, you know, it sort of links also with the children's stuff and the language. You remember what, you know, what was essential at the time. There's no reason why you would remember. I mean, who remembers what they had for lunch last Tuesday? not unless you have a ham sandwich every Tuesday lunchtime or every day, you know, so you don't remember that kind of thing. And I would remember the chopstick incident, but I wouldn't remember what I was wearing unless I would remember who was there. I wouldn't remember what we ate or what I was wearing. It's back to then the question about the photograph. I've got a sense that I do remember it because I've got the photographic evidence, but I wouldn't remember that. So.
Yeah. I wanted to ask you more about this idea that we need vocabularies to make memories.
Yeah.
Because we were teaching on this last week, Paulina, and we were reviewing some of the studies by Patricia Bauer, who has sort of an opposite view, which is that, you know, children, even if they've encoded something at 18 months where they have very little vocabulary, can spontaneously, if in an open-ended situation, given the beginning of something, fill in details with language that they didn't have at the time of encoding. And I wondered, like, bringing it together with what you were saying about cues to retrieval, if your paradigm, where you're asking people with a verbal cue, tell me something about cabbage, could be leading to the fact that people can only retrieve these verbally laid down memories, whereby if you were in a different kind of retrieval context, open-ended, or using music or perfume or something, you might not see that same signature.
Yeah, I think that's true. I think that's a possibility. Patricia Bauer's done some work in the past year that shows that, I think this is related and is helping answer the question, that shows that if you look at youngish children, they have earlier autobiographical memories. I mean, I had experience with my own children myself where, you know, they would remember stuff. At the age of four, they could remember stuff that happened at the age of two. That then as they get older, they can't. And interestingly, my four-year-old said to me on one occasion, Mummy, do you remember when we lived in the house with no stairs? We lived in a flat. And do you remember when we lived in the house with no stairs? And it struck me then that that was kind of a real example of that language that she had available to her then. She could remember it a couple of years later. She didn't call it a flat, or she didn't, you know, which is what we called it. It was her memory in words that she had available to her. She can't remember that now. And that's exactly what Bauer and her colleagues have. There's a paper from last year where they find that it's around the age of seven, there seems to be some kind of a switch whereby a lot of early memories are closed down to children. It's a really quite dramatic thing. There's a sort of graph that I was presenting to my students a couple of weeks ago, whereby they've got the age of four, five, six, quite a high level of remembering early stuff, and then it drops quite dramatically at the age of seven or eight. So, but yeah, you're right. I think it might be that there are other cues that you could use, but it's a difficult one to unpack, isn't it? Because if they don't have the language, then they can't talk about it.
I was just trying to get some, you know, you used the term that they don't lay those memories down, and I was wondering if you really meant that, or if you meant that. Maybe you have a different definition of autobiographical, so you can't report on it when you're 14 or 20.
Yeah. Well, it's certainly evidence that, you know, children, you know, babies can lay all kinds of memories down. I guess it, you know, maybe part of the thing about autobiographical memory is that it has a narrative element. So maybe we're kind of like, we're sort of like making a statement we don't need to make about the language, because, you know, it's like, why do you need to say it's about language? Because it's a story anyway of your life. But I think probably children from a pre-verbal age indicate knowledge of things, but with the extent to which that's autobiographical. I do think it's linked to a sense of self, though. If you look at amnesic patients, for example, who don't have a sort of past, they don't have a story to tell, then they find it difficult to sort of position themselves. And we've done some recent work with Scott Cole, a PhD student, who he looked at remembering and imagining. There's a lot of work going into now imagining the future. And you can't imagine if you don't have a present, and you can't have a present sort of self if you don't have a past. So I think autobiographical memory and the self sort of grow together in some way, at least, are certainly related, but it may well not be the whole story.
Thank you.
Well, if I can make an observation and ask a question.
Yeah.
The observation was, if I understood what you were saying, I thought you were a little bit mad yourself. In the sense that when you were talking about the Beatles, you gave us details in order to argue that this was a valid memory. Mm-hmm. It was 2215, it was Mr. Clark, and mm-hmm. so on. So I wondered whether you use the self-same myths in order yourself to say what is a valid and not valid memory. I suppose my question was, I'm not so just a psychologist, but I'm interested in the variability of the self, the variable self that mm-hmm. is critical. So mm-hmm. you know, we start from the premise that the self is not a single thing, it's a system, which has personal selves, there are collective selves, and so forth.
Yeah.
Now, insofar as you link memory to selfhood, then it raises a critical question about your understanding of selfhood, mm-hmm. and whether the nature of memory and what you're likely to memorize is likely be tied to the salience of different selves. Mm-hmm. If you make a national identity salient, are you going to get different autobiographical memories? If you make the fact that you're a football fan salient, are you then going to be able to invoke the different types of memories which otherwise aren't accessible? I'm like, this not being my area, is there any evidence which looks at the variability of the self and the way in which manipulating that variability impacts on memory?
No, there isn't, and I think you're absolutely right. I'm sure that's true. I'm sure that's true. That, and this is one of the things I mean about. I mean, that's maybe that's maybe my missing link and the way I need to think about it. We have an unsophisticated approach to the self, and it doesn't take into account all these different instantiations and different selves that one can take on, and I think that you know it. It limits us. I mean, you know, we're not getting people to put themselves in any particular sort of context, and that might be, you know, like, well, if you use music, it gives you something else, and if you use being a football fan or being a mother or whatever else is important to you. That's an interesting way to. I hadn't thought about it like that, but yeah, that's.
And am I being unfair and calling you mad?
What do I say to that one? Slightly. Not entirely. But no, I take your point about that as well. I take your point about that.
But I'm just wondering, what are your criteria of defining validity?
It's subjective. It's very difficult to, you know, so like with the last stuff, well, we cut out school uniform, my mother would have been there, and that sort of thing. That's really the first time we've done that. We, you know, we tend to sort of go through the memories and go, you know, joker or, you know, time waster, you know, that kind of category. And then really, you know, it's sort of like back to this issue of, you know, whether memories are true. I mean, these memories are probably not as the event originally happened. But a lot of the time that doesn't matter because, as I say, it's sort of people construct stories about their lives or retain develop stories about their lives that are self-preservatory.
I mean, the thing it reminded me of is that years ago there was a lot of work by discourse analysts about mm-hmm. how you make an account to make it seem real.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so the types of things that, and one of the points is precisely the point that what you do is you put in detail, including irrelevant detail.
Yeah.
You know, you say it was 10:21, I remember exactly, or for whatever reason. So mm-hmm. that was an interesting question then to get his memory release, is to say if you want to tell a memory, so it's to convince someone, tell it. So you get people to tell the memory to, you know, in different ways to be more or less convincing, then you look at the elements that they put in.
That relates to some of the work that we've done recently as well on truth and lies. So we've done like staged events where something dramatic happens in a lecture theatre, and then you get half the people to go away and tell you the truth, tell us what happened last week in the lecture, and then you say to the other group, right, we want you to sort of embellish this, and we've done it in various scenarios, you know, but you know, tell us something about this event, you know, lie about it in whatever kind of way, and then trying to look at our level of analysis was looking at the sort of linguistic features, and you know what elements. So there's the sort of word counts and personal pronouns, and you know, so they use more sort of personal pronouns and truthful accounts. And so we've tried to break it down like that. But I don't know that discourse analysis works. So it might be quite interesting to go back to that and see if there's something in that.
Well, there were a few more people questions, but there will be plenty of time to speak between over a glass of wine in the staff room, if anyone notices that. And I should present the psychology and neuroscience seminar. Oh. I didn't present you.
Brilliant, thank you. That's a nice touch.